stop, és akkor utána újra start.
Igen.
Tehát ezt ezzel lehet játszani.
Igen.
Jó.
Igen. Ha lehet, akkor ezt meg tudnál nem csinálni.
Más ne csinálja fel a filmből. Ne kezdje levelezni, nem tudom. Jó, de félre visszajövünk a kezdésre.
Thank you. Oh, okay. Thank you. This is an event which is window screened, so that means that what we are doing here is also followed by people who are in other countries. Some of them are on the other side of the globe. So I would like to welcome not only those who are here, but also those who are watching us from a distant place. Let me present the program. I think that you received it. Following this very short welcome, first we shall hear Tibor, who will present the research program itself. And after that, our three researchers, Chilo, Helena, and Daisy, will present the outcomes of the four pillars of the research. One of them, Helena, cannot be here physically with us, but she is following us, and she will present the part she was responsible through a video to us. She couldn't be here because she got a job offer in Switzerland and she had to travel there. After the four presentations, or five presentations, we shall have some time to ask questions and giving answers to that. And following this, when I shall give the moderation of the program to Judith, Tibor and me, we shall try to formulate some conclusions and perhaps ideas about how this activity could be followed up. So this is the program we plan for today. So I ask Chilo to start the first presentation. I asked for Tibor to present the whole research. Sorry, Tibor.
And characteristics. One is the strong commitment towards the knowledge management. So this program, the EDITE itself, and as a part of the work package 5, intend to produce, share, and apply new knowledge, focusing on teacher learning. The second issue I want to mention is the EDITE as an innovation. Using those categories that we usually apply when we are speaking about innovation, I think it is quite clearly possible to state that all kind of aspect, regarding all kind of aspects of the innovation, the EDITE brought some news. So the EDITE and behind that the cooperation with the partner organization can recognize as a product innovation. For instance, there is a special curricula which was developed close cooperation by the participating universities. It is a kind of organizational innovation. Maybe the most characteristic part of that is the cooperation with a different kind of very powerful kind of partner organizations in which the schools has the massive number, but behind that there are several other kind of organizations as well dealing with teacher education. It can be considered as a kind of process of innovation, especially the way of learning and teaching regarding the learning process of the ESRs, and especially the communication about the program, let's say, serve as a kind of marketing innovation. So after that, very short information about the role of the partner organizations in the doctoral program. The partner organizations has a special role establishing a learning environment, additional kind of learning environment for the ESRs, and also serve to act as a place where new knowledge were produced. And all issues were carried out in a kind of joint activities. Behind that, we had a partnership guidelines. I do not want to deal with these details, but I think it is important to mention that it's a kind of framework for us, how we can do the work, I mean the work between the doctoral schools and the partner organizations. At the starting point, we developed the kind of model how the partner organization can take place in the preparation of the doctoral students, and we developed three different levels for the cooperation, which is deeper and deeper itself, as you can see on the text. And it is not new also, it is at least for the EDITE community, it is a known issue. And maybe it is also wise to speak a little bit about the EDITE layers. I mentioned until now one, the scripts, how deepened the work with the partner organization in the program. But we also can speak about activities, learning, researching, networking. The third layers is the actors. The ESRs, the POs themselves, and the doctoral schools. And last but not least, we also can identify different levels of cooperation, personal, organizational, and program level. So I consider it important to mention these background before turn to the research program itself, because these kind of complexity and this innovative approach, of course, serve a kind of guidelines for us when we blend the aims and objectives of the research program itself. And here you can see the main goals or objectives and the specific ones. The main objective was that we want to uncover the characteristics, the nature of the partnership between universities and those organizations which took part in preparing their doctoral students. Behind that, we also recognize that it is an even broader world in this relation, and this is generally the school-university partnership. And then you can see the concrete objectives, the characteristics of the partnership, the added values, what we can produce during this work, what kind of obstacles, bottlenecks we had to face during the program, and how we consider the future for our staff. And Gabor mentioned that we defined four pillars for our small research program, and it is quite clear why we have these kind of pillars. It is a kind of what we apply is a mixed method, starting with a systematic literature review. We combine quantitative and qualitative research as well. Quantitative serve to get a kind of clear picture, and the qualitative serve to deepen our knowledge regarding this picture. And the case studies also serve to go even deeper and understand deeper regarding the relation between schools and universities, doctoral schools. This is a short list about the expected outputs, but I do not want to deal with that as our colleagues will speak about that. And last but not least, I want to mention one additional issue, what we did also in the frame of the program. That was a kind of looking back, looking ahead situation, organizing workshops, a workshop for the actors, university lecturers, partner organization representatives, and the ESRs, applying a special technique which inspired the participants to identify all those and answer all those questions I mentioned as a specific aim of the program. And if you will have a short time, you can go a little bit around and you can see the product of that. And lastly, I want to mention some conclusion. This workshop helped us to have a deeper understanding about the investigative relation between school and doctoral schools. And now I want to stress only one issue, which is very interesting and also important. And the question was that, which arose out of the group, what is the role, the real role of the doctoral schools? The classical answer was quite clear. There is no other than produce academics, produce researchers. And during the workshop, workshop arose another approach that the doctoral schools should prepare experts who own all kinds of competencies, which is important to plan, carry out, and apply research. Thank you for your attention.
And thank you also for stressing that this knowledge production process has been happening in this framework is not limited only to the production of the reports we shall see in a moment, but it also included those knowledge building events that you made reference for. And now let us see what the four reports and the four pillars are showing us. But before giving the floor to Chila, I also would like to say just one sentence that you got the reports with the invitation, but still there we shall have one more report Tibor is working on, which will be a kind of concluding report. So now Chila, please.
So, good afternoon, everybody. It is very good to be here with you today. It is actually a very special occasion because this is the last time that we meet under the aegis of EDITE in this circle. I am sure that most of you are very familiar with the structure of EDITE and the outcomes. Tibor and Dan were already gave you very valuable inputs about the project itself. But in case you would like to know more about the project, you can always visit the website or come and talk to us after this event. So instead of giving like an overview of the project, I would like to use these few minutes to tell you the story behind this presentation from a little bit more personal point of view. While I was preparing for today's presentations, and I'm using the plural because I will have to, I did a lot of reflection on the journey, the professional journey that we had in the past three and a half years. And it was truly astonishing to see all the transformation that happened on many different levels. I'm not talking only about my transformation, but on the institutional level, the consortium level. I remember the very first months of EDITE, back in 2016. It was not only that I changed countries, I moved to Hungary for the project to start my PhD studies, but I also was challenged to change my perspectives. The title of my PhD project was defined on the institutional level, so I couldn't really do anything with it, I couldn't change it, and it was quite a lengthy one. So the first challenge that I had to face was to fill up those seemingly empty words and phrases with meaning. Meaning that is scientifically valuable, meanings that is valuable for the practitioner, so for the world of practice, and with meanings that would make me go all days and all nights as a desperate PhD student to conduct research and actually get where we are today. I got to admit that I was lost in the beginning, and not only for weeks, but I was lost for months. It was very overwhelming to find a good focus, a valuable focus for my study, among all the knowledge that is already out there related to teacher education and teachers learning. And then one of my supervisors, Eric Bock, who is sitting here with us today, introduced me to the methodology of systematic literature reviews, and then a whole new world opened up to me. This method, with its very rigorous systematic approach, helped me to identify relevant research trends and actually gaps as well in these research trends related to teacher education, especially initial teacher education, because that was, in that title that I got. And it contributed a great deal to define the focus of my PhD research. Ever since, I am a big fan of this method, and whenever I have the chance to appropriate it, I do so. So this is also an opportunity for that. When we started the joint research on school-university partnerships, so we did this circle that we are here today, we were first focusing on the EDITE context, but slowly we stepped beyond these frames and we decided that we would do international case studies and also systematic literature review on the topic of school-university partnerships. So in the next 10-15 minutes, I will briefly introduce you to our endeavors in this pillar first. I think this pillar had the biggest number of contributors. It was Helena working on it, who is here with us through Skype from Switzerland. Judith Kim, who's also not here from Myanmar, and Daisy, and of course myself. But I also think that this pillar was a very resource-intensive model, so it was a venturous challenge that we actually accepted. And in a short time, you will see where we got. But let's take a step back and let's see what literature says about systematic reviews, so about the method itself. So the systematic literature reviews are a method of making sense of large bodies of information and a mean of contributing to answer specific research questions. So there's like a big difference between traditional literature reviews, where we have the freedom to, you know, stir the review in the direction that we want to. But if we do a systematic literature review, then we really have to be rigorous. Actually, Patrick Flynn and Roberts are two of the important figures of this method, and they also, you know, define a lot of different ways in which systematic literature review can be used. So it can be used to reveal what works and what does not work. I think this is even most important. To map out areas of uncertainty, to identify very little project or no research projects have been actually done, so where we need these studies, and to flag up areas where spurious certainty abounds, so where we think that we know more than we do. Because, you know, as researchers, this happens a lot, that we tend to deal with things that are already researched because that's where we feel comfortable. These methods seem to be a valuable addition to our joint research, where we aim to understand the nature of school-university partnerships within and beyond the EDITE context. However, due to the very rigorous nature of the methodology and the constraints that we had, so that we had only 6 months to conduct this research, we agreed that instead of aiming for a truly systematic literature review, we will conduct a literature review with a strong systematic aspect. And this actually means that we try to adhere to the rigorous methodology as much as it was feasible, but from one point onward, we had to differ from it, and I will tell you later why. So, this is how we work. After identifying the existing literature reviews, traditional and systematic, to create just a common base, a common language for our team, we developed the so-called review protocol, which is actually a set of rules that we followed when we identified the studies, when we decided on inclusion and exclusion, of studies from further analysis. And according to our protocol, we limited our population to publications that involve university or university staff, and public schools or teachers in service and pre-service, focusing on the partnerships between schools and universities. The identification of the studies with a predefined search string that everyone used in our team took place in 4 platforms, in 4 databases, and these are EBSCO, ERIE, Google Scholar, and EU documents. And we included English language publications only published after 2015, with a limited geographical focus on Europe, the United States, and Australia. And now you may have a lot of questions, why did we decide on these rules, these parameters. I have to say that this was mostly because of the time constraints, so we had to take into consideration the resources that we had to have. But still, I hope that at the end you will think that even with this very focused, very narrow sample, we could produce something valuable. After the numerous rounds of filtering and exclusion and expert decisions of narrowing the sample, we chose 49 studies that were suitable for further analysis, and simultaneously with this task, we started to work on the development of a code system in which we coded the studies later. Here you can see, I mean, you can understand modules of the code system, but when we discussed the results people get back to me. So we extracted many different kinds and types of information for the studies. Having the code system developed and piloted, the team started the actual coding of the 49 studies. In the case of 10 studies, we conducted double coding, which means that these 10 studies were coded individually by two researchers, and since the level of consistency was very high in all cases, so it was about 80-85%, the remaining 39 studies were coded only by one coder. The analysis was based on the coded data, and this actually means that the information we extracted from the studies, in some instances we conducted some kind of a quantitative analysis, so we quantified what we extracted. In some other cases we conducted thematic analysis to get some emerging themes out of the extracted information. And now let's see some of our results. The majority of the studies, so the 49 studies, we selected, were published in 2017 and 2018, so these are very, very recent things, and have a geographical focus on the United States of America and Canada. Only 5 studies reported on an international aspect. So the rest had either a national, regional, or even a smaller settlement-wise or institutional focus. The majority of the studies, and we are talking about 33 studies, is based on a qualitative methodological approach, 9 studies on a mixed methodological approach, and none of the studies use the quantitative approach as a standalone approach. The next aspect that we looked at was the keywords in the studies as defined by the authors of these studies. During the coding, we extracted these keywords, grouped them and counted their occurrence, and we wanted to demonstrate what keywords are mostly associated with these studies related to school-university partnerships. The 3 phases of teacher education continuum appeared among the keywords. So initial teacher education, which is on the top, professional development in 7 studies, and in action only 2. So even if you look at the bars, it's very, you know, explicit that initial teacher education was the most used keyword. We will get back to this because this is like a recurring result. 8 of the studies did not include any explicit research questions, because in the next phase we looked at, you know, what kind of research questions the authors of these studies formulated. So what were the things that they were interested to find out? So 8 studies did not define any explicit research questions, and in the remaining 41 studies, we identified 79 research questions. So now this is our sample, and we actually conducted a thematic analysis with these questions. We labeled each research question with its underlying theme, and the most frequent label was the teacher preparation. Surprise, surprise! This is, you know, this somehow resonates with the previous slides. So teacher preparation label appeared in the case of 21% of all the research questions, indicating that the research questions aim to reveal the different aspects of teacher preparation, teacher learning, and mostly in relation to initial teacher education. An additional 6.3% of the questions was labeled with a practicum, again in the context of initial teacher education. There were numerous other labels, for example, policy program and project evaluation, principles, roles, STEM, roots into teaching, knowledge management, etc., etc. But surprisingly, there were only 2 labels which had some kind of a negative connotation to it, and this is the forced partnership and challenges or issues of SOUP. And I will tell you the exact numbers. So only 2.5% of the questions wanted to find out what does it mean to have a forced partnership between schools and universities, what are the different aspects of it, and only 3.8% of the research questions dealt with the challenges and issues of school-university partnerships. We also extracted various information on the characteristics of the school-university partnerships as reported in the studies by the authors. So having a look at the nature of the partnerships, the majority of these, 80, almost 90% of the studies focus on informal partnerships, so where the partners have a formal agreement, like a contract, which defines their collaboration. Six studies did not identify the nature of the partnerships at all, and no studies dealt with informal partnerships. So this is again a question, does it mean that there are no informal partnerships, or is it just not in the interest of the researchers? With four categories, we in the book system, we try to reflect on previous research, and we also try to grasp what is in the focus, what is the essence of the partnership. As this slide demonstrates, more than half of the studies focus on school-university partnership in the context of teacher education, and mostly in initial teacher education. I'm sorry about the picture. I doubt that you can see it, but I think that there will be, you can see it, okay, it's even better. But I'm sure that we will also upload the presentation, so if you're interested in the numbers, you can check it yourself. So again, this recurring trend in initial teacher education is the context for school-university partnerships up here in the focus, in the essence of the studies as well. And around a quarter of the studies, 22.4 studies, deal with continuous professional development, but again, we stay within the teacher education, the teacher learning rationale. And then, significantly less studies step beyond this teacher learning, teacher education rationale. 10% of the studies identify the school development as the context of this partnership, and 16.3 studies identify research as the context of the partnership. Moreover, the authors create explicit links between the partnership and innovation only in 12.3% of the articles. So this was just a brief overview of the results. You may find more in our final reports, which will be uploaded to the website. But even based on these results, we can conclude that our data has revealed a set of common characteristics of research projects, research papers, and school-university partnerships from the past 5 years. And these characteristics are a few examples here. So most of them have a rather a national or lower level geographical focus than international. The research partnerships are mostly formal, when there is a formal agreement, so they don't focus on informal partnerships. They tend to argue more from an institutional perspective than from an individual perspective. And based on my experience and previous research, I do think that in school-university partnerships, the individual level, so what happens on the personal level, is a very important factor. But for some reason, this didn't really occur in these studies in our review. The qualitative approach is the dominant one. They interpret, so the authors, these studies interpret the school-university partnership mostly in the context of initial teacher education. And there is a tendency to neglect the what did not happen aspect of these partnerships. So all these studies try to, you know, focus on the good things. And I think that I am a positive person, but I do believe that sometimes it's good to look at what is not working. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Gina. So this was the literature reading part. And now I shall invite Sheila to present the quantitative part of our research. But before you start, let me just mention that I know about at least one person who is watching us through the video streaming. I just got a photo of myself from Kinkin, from the other side of the globe, from Myanmar. So please show us the outcomes of the quantitative part.
Thank you. So welcome again. It's all very good to be here with you. This time you will deal a little bit more with numbers. numbers. I will present you the benefits, the bottlenecks, and potentials of school unique partnerships. Again, in the EDITE perspective and beyond, so in the next step, we will look at what do the numbers tell us. So the EDITE project, and now I'm repeating some things that you have already heard today from Natalie and Tibor. So the EDITE project drew on the profound interdependence of educational research and practice. Therefore, the partnerships or these collaborations, or we can use many different synonyms to describe them, between schools as the representatives of the world of practice and universities as the representatives of the world of educational research, had significant importance in our EDITE project. During the project lifetime, an enormous amount of theoretical knowledge and practical experience was gathered, was accumulated concerning the complex world of the school-university partnerships. And with this pillar, we try to dig into these aspects. But before we we talk about the results, let's have a quick overview on what we know from the literature. The definition of the school-university partnership is very broad, but we chose to follow this one, which goes like, generally, it is a mutual relationship aimed at improving the quality of teaching and learning through bridging of theory and practice among school teachers, teacher educators, and the researchers. There are numerous types of partnerships models existing, so here are just a few examples. We can talk about formal and informal partnerships based on whether the partners have formal agreement. We can talk about long-term contract-based agreement on the equitable sharing of resources. We can talk about service partnerships where the university provides support and training for their staff and teacher educators working within the schools. We can talk about schools as merely research sites for researchers. And we can talk about, for example, complementary partnerships where both institutions have their agendas, their own agendas, and these are implemented in parallel manner, and when they can, they help each other out, they support each other. In EDITE, the early stage researchers, so Helena, Daisy, and myself, so we were encouraged to collaborate with the partner organizations of the project, and to frame this collaboration, a so-called partnership guide was developed, and this guideline differentiated three types of partnership models. So although on the previous slide you saw that we can talk about many different types, in this research we use this differentiation. So we can talk about the simple model of partnership that is characterized by mutual visits of the partners, information sharing, at least 1 year in meeting. Then we can talk about the structured model, where supporting the ESRs, the researchers, the PhD students, to conduct their field research in the partner organization is in the focus. So again, this is somehow a one-directional partnership. And finally, we can talk about the intensive model, in which partners intensively engage in common knowledge sharing and knowledge creation. So this is actually where a bi-directional communication and collaboration takes place. The second theme that we identified in the literature are the benefits of school-university partnerships, which can be defined as a reciprocal development of schools and teacher education departments, improved learning opportunities for participants and their students and their pupils as well, the increased relevance of educational research, and the reduced isolation for teachers and academics. So again, to merge the two worlds that we still feel that are very far away from each other sometimes, but not today and not here. Despite the benefits of school-university partnerships, there are instances where it is difficult to sustain such a collaboration, such a partnership. One huge obstacle can be the language barrier. The communication skills vary a great deal among the participants, and cultural and linguistic diversity issues can arise easily. Secondly, school-university partnerships are affected by the different perspectives of approaches undertaken by the participating institutions. Therefore, sharing common understandings and values is just is just as important as acknowledging and respecting these different perspectives in the partnerships. Thirdly, so this is the third thing of the literature review, having functional structures that accommodate the needs of both partners can be also challenging. Literature relates this to their sense of effective school, university, communication, and the lack of shared vision between these partners. Then, insufficient expert knowledge has been found to hamper the effectiveness of the partnerships. And lastly, time management and time availability are also some of the more major challenges partnerships might face. And personally, I can relate to this last one. So based on these premises, as the second pillar of the school-university partnership research, we conducted in the framework of EDITE, and we embarked on a two-folded research endeavor, which was a quantitative inquiry into the benefits, the challenges, and the sustainability of school-university partnerships. Our endeavors were two-folded because, on the one hand, we had the intention to explore the knowledge created by the project participants within the 3 years of EDITE, in a broader, in the international context, because we had EDITE in 5 countries. While on the other hand, we also aim to unfold the present-day situation of school-university partnerships within a narrower national context of Hungary. In both cases, we relied on a questionnaire that our team developed. The questionnaire was slightly adapted to specific contexts and specific target groups, but some of the questionnaire items remain the same throughout different phases of this pillar, so therefore we could look at the results through comparative lens. The first phase involved the participants of the EDITE program from 5 countries. According to the role of these participants, we could differentiate 5 subsamples, and these are partner organization representatives, researchers, or the so-called ESRs, national project coordinators, supervisors, and the technical secretariats. For data collection, a core questionnaire with 82 items was developed, and in the frame of a pilot, it was also tested with the support of an expert team. And then in the second phase, so in the Hungarian national context phase, we aim to rebuild the state of art situation of school-university partnerships in Hungary. We invited school representatives from Eastern level 1, 2, and 3, so from basic school to up to secondary education, including vocational educational institutions. And similarly to the first study for data collection, a core questionnaire with 33 items was developed. And again, we piloted this questionnaire to within the expert group. And due to the very limited time, I'm going to present the results along the 3 main themes that we identified in the literature, discussing the EDITE and the Hungarian cases together. But in the report, we made a clear differentiation between the 2 cases. So if you're more into the EDITE case, you can just read that chapter. Or if you would like to know more about the Hungarian case, then you will have pages and pages on results. So let's see the first result of the first team, where we looked at the types of partnerships. So excellent and effective partnerships are really challenging to establish, since they are based on mutual trust, mutual respect, and joint endeavors in those who are involved in these partnerships. And these take time to achieve. So, you know, it's really nice when we put people in one room, but we cannot force these kind of things, because then we talk about the forced partnerships, and those very few studies that dealt with the forced partnerships show that it's not really effective on the long term. So this is clearly visible, and in the EDITE context, so first I'm talking about the EDITE context, the intensive model of partnerships where the partners intensively engage in common knowledge sharing, knowledge creation, activities was by far least common among the respondents. Again, I hope you can see the numbers. So the intensive model was identified in only 14.3 of the cases, whereas the structured model was the most common. stepping beyond the EDITE context, according to the Hungarian case, more than two-thirds of the or the participating schools maintain some kind of a partnership with universities. In most cases, the respondents reported that the purpose of the partnerships was identified in a joint manner between the schools and the universities, so they work together on identifying these purposes and aims. However, there is a contradicting result that revealed that the participants agreed to a smaller extent that the school staff and the university staff actually worked together when it came to the implementation of these partnerships. Further research into this issue might reveal where and why things get off the rail, to use that phrase, so that schools and universities identify joint purposes in the beginning, but then this joint nature of the partnership weakens by time. Another result seemed to back up the idea of this weakening joint nature of the partnership. The influence of partners on each other's practice does not prove to be a proportional thing. According to the respondents, universities have a significantly bigger influence on schools' practice than the other way around. And this, if we think about the three types of the partnerships in the EDITE context that I introduced, so this would fall into either the symbol or the structure model of partnerships, but not the intensive model. So not when we talk about a bidirectional collaboration, where the partners intensively engage in common knowledge sharing and knowledge creating activities. Then, going on to the benefits of partnerships within the EDITE context, supporting the doctoral students in acquiring their practical experiences and realizing the empirical part of their research emerged to be the most important benefit by the respondents. This is understandable since throughout the quiet short period of the 3 years of EDITE, those involved in the partnership focused on the most urgent issue, and from a project management point of view, this would be the supporting the ESRs, the researchers, to finish their PhDs on time. So again, this would be this one. And now we can get the yellow bars. Although a little bit less, but compared to other benefits, still a high achiever statement among the respondents was the importance of supporting mutual knowledge sharing and learning between the universities and their partner organizations. This shows that those involved in the partnership have somewhat similar understanding of the importance of these mutual benefits. And now we have a look at the Hungarian national level, where we can outline a very similar pattern. For example, the mutual knowledge sharing is indicated as a highly important benefit by most of the respondents. However, the numbers representing the respondents' actual gain through these partnerships related to these specific benefits in the EDITE context were lower in every case than the importance they assigned to them. So now we will look at, or we can look at the yellow and the blue bars. So the yellow bars show us the importance of these statements by the respondents, and the blue bars show us how much the respondents thought that they actually gained through the same benefit. So as you can see, they assigned quite a high importance to the benefits, so they realized the partnerships have a lot of different aspects of beneficial advantages, but when it comes to actual gains, there is still space for improvement, let's put it that way. And then, in order to reveal what worked and what did not work within the EDITE context, we took a closer look at the limitations of the partnerships. It wasn't a surprise that the limited time availability, especially in the case of the university-based staff, emerged to be the most urgent limitation. And there is a myriad of studies discussing how overwhelmed university-based staff are in their many different roles. However, for our team, a more interesting result might be that the respondents found the insufficient expert knowledge as the least significant limitation, meaning that all the involved subgroups, so even if you look at the whole sample, but if you differentiate that on the university based on the researchers or the partner organization representatives too, So all of these respondents thought they had valuable knowledge and or experience to share. This implies that the hindering factor of school-university partnerships might be found somewhere in between the two worlds. According to the results, this can be due to the lack of relevant conceptions of cooperations. And this limitation also scored high among the respondents. That reveal that those involved in school-university partnerships generally consider such partnerships, such collaborations, as a beneficial endeavor, and they emphasize the importance of mutual learning, mutual knowledge creation, and knowledge sharing. But for some reasons, in everyday practice, the well-known gap between theory and practice leaves its footprint on these school-university partnerships. To at least manifest, for example, the dominance of one partner in the partnership, usually the university is influencing the school's practice more. And according to the respondents, they mostly think they have valuable knowledge and experience that they would be worthy of sharing, but the recipe of doing this to bridge the gap between the schools and the universities requires additional attention. And I do know that my colleagues who will present after me will give you insights into that, because with quantitative numbers, this is very difficult. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. And a special thanks also for taking the lion's share in the whole research, taking responsibility for two pillars.
And just one slide remark, because I would really like to thank my colleagues with whom I worked in the quantitative part. It was Daisy and Judith, so the three of us did this.
And also the doctoral students who took part. Okay, now we shall see the presentation on the qualitative pillar by Helena, who, as I said, cannot be here with us, but she prepared a pre-recorded video, and I hope that at the end she can answer questions if we have any to them through the internet. So now this is Helena's presentation.
Just a small remark before we give the virtual floor to Helena. She prepared two videos. Firstly, we will see a very short one where she greets us, and then we will go to the actual for the actual presentation on her pillar on the qualitative part.
Hello, everyone. My name is Helena, and most of you might know me, but for those who don't, I am one of the early stage researchers of EDITE, a graduate of the program who has been leading the school-university partnership, particularly the qualitative pillar of this study. I have been working closely with Kim Kim and Dana, and it is just an unfortunate luck that we have that we neither of three of us is currently in the country to be there with you physically. Dana is in Kazakhstan, her home country, and Kim Kim is in Myanmar, her home country, and I have been called for new challenges and to deliver some new good work, so I will be greeting you from Switzerland today. We hope that our physical absence will not be too much of a challenge or a barrier in communicating our results or communicating with you. We're in the 21st century, so luckily we have good technology that we can use as a tool to communicate all of these ideas. And we hope that you will find the presentation as enjoyable and interesting as much as if I was there physically with you. I will be switching off the front camera and turning it to the screen camera so I can lead you through my PowerPoint presentation, and I hope it all will be clear and enjoyable. The title of our qualitative study is Benefits, Bottlenecks, and Potentials of School-University Partnership at Doctoral Level Perspectives of ELTE. And I know it sounds a little bit complex and mouthful, but it is actually what we did. So we wanted to see the in-depth qualities that reflect benefits and drawbacks, as well as potentials of SUP, at, particularly at the doctoral level, which could be provided through EDITE. I'll start very shortly with the context, because this is the most important thing. So we already know that we are working through the dimension of EDITE, which has been established as an innovative training network, or ITN, under the framework of Marie Sklodowska-Curie actions. And this is very important because the aim of the ITN was to develop a specific type of research that is creative, entrepreneurial, and innovative. For the ITN, for this project to achieve this, they needed a number of partnerships and collaborations across different levels and dimensions, which means cross-national and cross cross-institutional. And the figure, the little picture on the on your left side actually portrays very well this, because of these little triangles, which are official EDITE partners. Initially, EDITE had 23 official partners, out of which most of it, more than half, were schools. And in the document, in the final report, you actually can see the spread of these different partners across five different countries. It was meant to be a long-term cooperation, these partnerships, and they aimed at sharing knowledge, as well as engaging public in defining and exploiting research results. It was also based on Salzburg principles of doctoral education, which in context of teacher education should serve as a platform for transformative potential of teachers, schools, and other partner organizations, as well as for the support of cross-national horizontal sharing of knowledge and good practices. At ELTE, who had the dominant role, the main leading role for establishing partnerships within the EDITE, at the very beginning, several types and models of partnerships were defined. And you can see in this table, they range from simple to intensive model, which differ from level of cooperation to frequency and main features. We can already see the intensive model indeed has the most engagement in knowledge sharing and their direct involvement in partners in everyday project delivery, but it also requires a lot of resources, in particular human and time resources. And we all know that in doctoral research and in teachers' reality, time is something that we don't have much of in any case. So so these models were basically to kind of navigate the partners, the researchers, the partners, the old institutions involved, to say, okay, you can actually go for a simple model, because this is what you get with a simple model. But if you don't have the time, the capacities for an intensive model, maybe you should consider the two other models. And it was the structure of this table was not to say that, yes, we all have to achieve the intensive model, but to kind of say that, okay, there is different ways of doing a partnership. Apart from this, we did have some little supporting literature, and this was mainly because, and for sure, Sheila already introduced you with extensive literature in the pillar one that we did. So within this pillar, we focus more on other things, but we did want to define partnership as a project of two or more parties that share a common goal, which cannot be achieved by one of the parties independently. We also wanted to kind of stress that at the doctoral level, school-university partnership gets another dimension, and it does mean a significant improvement that cannot be achieved without the creation of the research tradition that gives access to teachers, for teachers to research, and also has research feeding into teaching. One last thing to mention is the knowledge triangle, which I'm sure was already mentioned by some of my colleagues, which puts in a triangular position the researcher, the universities, and the schools, so that they can kind of share and collaborate common interests. Now, just to inform you very shortly about methodology, so we did a qualitative exploratory research within Pillar 3, using semi-structured interviews with three main categories of informants. The first one were early-stage researchers and self-funded researchers, so the researcher perspective. The second one was university staff, so basically heads of program supervisors and administrative staff. And the third one were partner organization representatives. We did coding based on categories emerging from interviews, and it was also slightly inductive and productive to that respect. And we did cross-coding because we had actually three of us working with the interviews, so just to kind of ensure reliability and synchronicity. Two or three of us looked at the same interview, and we just wanted to see if we're all seeing the same things or if someone is not missing an important element. It was a very good activity, it was a very good exercise for all three of us, and for me, leading the group, and I'm very happy to talk more about it at another occasion. But the findings, it's basically the most interesting of all the Pillar 3. And when I wanted to summarize the findings, I thought, like, how would I present them? And I always think of a very nice visual way to present my presentations. So I've decided to categorize the findings in three main groups. The first one being connection done by the institutions. The second being findings related to researchers. And the third being characteristics of the school-university collaboration. And I will touch shortly each of these three, but this is kind of just for you to see the bigger picture. If we look at the connection making, so the initial contact between the partners was done because an application for the ITN had to be done. So the application required university and non-university partners. They were usually based on personal contact between the university professor and a school leader. But in some cases, for instance in Hungary, they were also based on a longer tradition of working together, where there is a historical kind of collaboration between some schools and some universities. The types of institution that were involved span at all levels of schooling, plus there were other relevant institutions, for instance, research agencies or authorities, and even non-governmental institutions. In some cases, new partners were added later when people have discovered that, well, someone is a valuable partner for EDITE. But there were cases, not very, very many, but for instance in Poland, there was a case where partners were, so to say, dismissed. They were not really dismissed with like an angry note, but they were kind of, they shook hands and said, okay, this is really not working, neither of us was getting benefits that we expected, so let's have it here and be done with it. If we look at the findings from the perspective of researchers, it might seem logical, but for us it was very significant to understand that research topic and methodology did matter a lot. If the research topic was ill-defined or it was not particularly interesting from the perspective of practitioners, the collaboration would be so-so. But also with methodology, the collaboration gets in depth if the methodology is well conceived or well thought through. For instance, qualitative methodologies, ethnographies, action research, and so on, had a better impact on the partnership between researchers and the practitioners, while, for instance, surveys or questionnaires didn't have much of a kind of depth when we talk about the connection. This seems very common sense, but yet this was repeated many, many times in many, many interviews. Another very interesting thing was the power relationship coming from the university, and some of the researchers noticed that there is a culture of institutional power which they didn't like. So most of the universities thought that they have that they can for granted when they go to schools and take data or whatever, be the knowledge sharers and so on, without thinking of practitioners as potential knowledge sharers. So this was noticed by a couple of researchers in their interviews, and they as they said, as this particular insert says, the partnership should reflect the equal relationship, and not that someone is more knowledgeable or someone is better or so on. If we look the findings from the ease factors, again, the research topic renders as it is quite logical, as well as leaders' readiness to participate in the project. The trust between partners is something that reflects on the trust that was done in the initial connection, and there is also the openness to find the best working model. Another very interesting thing is this ability to share the results, and this is kind of an interesting thing because not all the results were easy to share. Some results were done with a very critical perspective using critical theories, in which they would examine inequalities, democracy, citizenship, and so on. And these were not always the finest kind of flattering results. So the ability, the openness of schools to have this knowledge, as well as the courage, so to say, of researchers to share them, is something that kind of, if there was a thing like that, that would ease the partnership. Looking from the difficulties perspective, of course, language is an obvious hardship because it did involve people coming into countries where they don't know the language. And another obvious thing would be if there was no benefit from one or both sides, the collaboration would lead to misunderstanding and frustration, and this would be a difficulty in having a good partnership. Lack of resource, like time, as well as lack of interest due to the topic or the methodology, was something that was quite often also perceived by the interviewees. Finally, if we look at the benefits and the motives, most of our interviewees talk about the challenge of the system or changing the current system, and this is kind of a driving motive to work together. EDITE was seen as a prestigious project, and the exchange of ideas both ways has been seen as something that could benefit, so teachers could learn more about what the researchers find in their research studies, but also at the university end, teachers also thought like, okay, universities could benefit from seeing the teaching as it goes on and to kind of improve their teaching skills. So this is kind of to be exposed to the teaching practice. And of course, these kind of, everyone realized that these kind of projects also give appreciation to teaching as a profession, which kind of upgrades it. And this is kind of all set within this little quotation that for educational science it's really useful to create networks. So I hope this kind of gives you a good overview of the findings and the analysis that we did. And when I was thinking of how to conclude or how to kind of give the final say in this presentation, and this is also reflected in our document, because there were so many recommendations and conclusions done by the interviewees, we thought of not really transforming their words, but actually giving what they already said. And I chose this quotation among many to kind of portray this, and it goes, "I would like to build a teacher education curriculum in which truly practice and theory would intertwine through research. I would like to have research-focused curriculum of teacher education. I would like research to be integrated into teacher education so that teachers are researchers. I think this is the best way for teacher development. I think this is the best way for teacher professionalization, and this is through continuous research. This breaks down the barriers, the false barriers between academia and the world of practice, and this kind of snobism of academia that is based on nothing." As you see, and this is just one of many very interesting recommendations coming from the interviewees, and I hope this kind of also concludes well my presentation. I would like to thank you from the qualitative team, from Dana, Kikin, and myself, and I wish you a very nice rest of the day. Bye-bye, thank you.
Thank you, Helena. And now the last pillar was the case study, and this will be presented by Dana, please.
Coordinate the case study pillar, and it was a pleasure to work with my colleagues. We had the opportunity of examining four case studies in three different countries, this being Myanmar, Spain, and Hungary. But first, before going to the case studies and what we found out in the analysis, we will go like very, very briefly to the school-university partnership definition. If you want to see more definitions or the whole literature review, you are up for a treat because we have an 85-long research report. But again, the school-university partnerships are partnerships or programs between schools and universities established with the aim of improving the quality of teacher education and facilitate the best output from the students. So as I said, we have two case studies in Myanmar, one in Spain, and one in Hungary. We chose these countries basically because we had students from Myanmar, and it was a bit opportunistic. but it was something that did not take a lot of time, and we had people that will connect us with officials working in schools in these countries. So Myanmar has two case studies. The first one was the collaborative partnership in training for new primary education in Myanmar. So it is based on the CREATE project for curriculum change. And the second one was a school-university partnership in initial teacher training, a glance at the current collaboration between teacher training universities and schools. So we looked at the case of two teacher training institutions and the collaboration with the schools. I will not go deep into them because we have them in the report and we are a bit squeezed with the time. In Spain, we look at the professional development centers in Spain or centros de formación profesional and the experience of teachers and the leadership while trying to implement a professional development project in one of the schools. So this is the most special case study because first we are in Hungary and because this project, well, this case study was developed with by one of our colleagues, and it's about opening up educational research-based development in vocational education. That is a topic that is very close to my heart, and it's a project that I think it has worked very well and that has actually created opportunities in the Hungarian and international scenario. But I would like about the Hungarian case study, my colleague Judith Schaaf to give a few words about it.
I was not preparing to give a talk about this project, and our time is very short, so I will only very shortly summarize what this project was about. It's a project initiated by the Technical University of Budapest, and it's about open content development, which means that they wanted to develop open access contents that is a kind of innovative way of teaching vocational education subject in the area of economics and engineering. These were the two main disciplines. And one of the prerequisites of the project was to involve practitioners, so it's very similar to that. And this project was initiated by the Teacher Education Center of the university, so they have very good contacts and first-hand experience with teachers, vocational education teachers from secondary schools. So this was cooperation began on a natural basis and on a voluntary basis. The schools were invited, those schools who were motivated and interested in the project. So a network of about 12 schools was formed, and they, together with the university, based on research results, started to renew the vocational educational contents of the school subjects. So the project had a prerequisite at the university because they already started to reform the university level, master teaching level training programs at the university. They were experiencing with micro contents, which means small learning units based on visual representations. So large chunks of contents, vocational education subjects, were compressed into a small picture and text unit, and it means that it's very effective for the wiser generation, so the students or the pupils at secondary schools, basic schools, who are used to the internet consumption habits, so they can only focus for something to have a shorter time and not so deep. And these micro contents help them to focus their interest and focus their attention. And another unique case that I did with Gipart for 2 days was that these micro contents were developed with the help of the students, or with the contributions of the secondary students and the schools.
Thank you very much, Judy. So I wanted Judy to describe this case study because it is something that is happening right now in Hungary, and it's a very important case study from my point of view because the process of how they have been working in micro context has involved a lot of students, not just the teachers. And also the use of micro context, based on what the leader of the project told us, is that the students get so engaged that they want to keep doing them. And they learn based on the fact that some of us, we are not digital natives, so they are learning in a different way. And this is one of the ways the development of these micro contents, has like given the opportunity of engaging two different generations of the new learners and us as old teachers, let's say. And it's something working right now in Hungary. So that's why I wanted to do a special emphasis on this project. And please read it if you have. So before going to the elements of successful partnerships, there is a lot of literature about it, so we center ourselves in four elements that, based on the literature, make the school-university partnership successful. So we center our literature review in this school-university partnership. So the first one is stakeholder engagement, second one, teacher learning outcomes, the third one is enabling networks and partnerships, and the last one is program sustainability. I have to say that, for example, the first one is named in the theory review, in the fourth one. And the second one somehow is related to the fourth one again. So this is how we decided to group them. There is literature about these four elements, but there are several authors that describe them in different ways. So this was our decision, like research-wise. But again, it was because we found a lot of material and a lot of authors writing up these four concepts. So about stakeholders engagement, and I am a bit nervous because all of you are stakeholders. Maybe you will agree or disagree with these elements. There were these sub-elements that were named. While we were doing the interviews, we did interviews with leadership, teacher trainers, and teachers, and they mentioned that early communication is key, so everybody that is going to be involved in the school should know what is happening. We had a lot of cases in which teachers said that they didn't know what was happening until they received student teachers for them to tutor. So they were incredibly dissatisfied because they didn't know what was happening. Also close planning, because if you involve the stakeholders from the beginning, they feel that it's part of their duties, that they know what is happening and this is their project as well. Continuous consultation, we had the opportunity to contrast two of the case studies in which one, they had like even weekly visits to the school, like sometimes bi-weekly, but there was a continuous communication. And another one in which, unfortunately, the person that was in charge from the university visited the school at the beginning and at the end of the project to see how it worked. So we had the opportunity to contrast these 2 points, so it was very interesting and gave us the importance of a continuous consultation. Also, risk management. There was one case study that actually took into consideration what would happen if key stakeholders will not work in the school anymore. So that has to do with the contact person dilemma, because in some schools, all the people that were like key that had the knowledge were retiring. And it's something that is a trend that is going on in a lot of schools. But the people with the knowledge are retiring, what do we do if they retire in the middle of the project? So this risk management was very, very important for us. Compromise, which was something that the teachers and the leadership actually mentioned a lot. And the contact person dilemma. This has to do, as I said, with risk management, but it was also something that has happened a few times. There is just one key person, so if this person is either not available, retires or something happens, the project might stop. So it's better to have all of these elements before, like a early communication and continuous consultation, in order to don't have just one person in which the whole project relies on. The second one, I will try to go faster, was enabling networks. So there were three tiers, three different classifications of how these new networks can be enabled. The single-tier system is collaboration between university professor and classroom teachers. That is normally the simple and most basic element of the partnership. The multiple tiers are the collaboration, is when the collaboration is extended to participants from other schools, districts, or institutions. And the third one is called complex broker. And the university leaders incorporate external experts who work with both the university and the school participants. Also, there was a fourth one that is not mentioned here, and it's when a project grows enough in order for the partnership to involve national or international entities that work in the topic of education. The third one is teaching learning outcomes, and I will go very quickly on that. These teacher learning outcomes have to be taken into consideration when the project is being planned. And one is for the purpose of designing content. Also, to decide which partnerships will be more successful in the schools, and with the purpose of the stakeholders to be assigned different roles. And last one, program sustainability, and this has to do with it's connected with the first one as I mentioned. So probably you are going to see this topic twice. The commitment to healthy relationships between the school and the university in Spain specifically, there was one institution that was so tired of having students every week with different projects looking for teachers who will answer the questions. So they were like completely exhausted of that. And the school was being actually very, not close, but try to limit the number of students from universities and the number of projects that actually were accepted into the school. Availability of resources, if we have enough resources for the whole project, the quality of leadership and the quality of communication, which was mentioned, and the engagement of stakeholders, and the engagement of stakeholders that we talked before. And just to finish, it's a bit small, but I can send you the presentation after. So from the case study, we also identified the perspectives of the leadership, the student, the teacher trainers, and the teachers about what will make a school-university partnership successful. So they mentioned four different elements. One was learning, and this involves mutual learning, about the assessment of the partnership, continuous feedback, and alignment of practices during the partnership. The second one was expectation, sorry. And there was a lot of expectation when the teacher trainers heard about a new project about innovation. They expected something innovative to come with the school-university partnership. Also learning about teaching and to improve their practices, and also a lot of them expected actually something about ICT and technical skills to be developed. The third one was change. So what happened was that there was a change in the schools about assessment, knowledge accessibility, hierarchy, how they see the people at the university, because in some cases there was a problem in which they didn't feel that a university professor would be actually aware of what they were living every day. So they actually got closer to the university and university teachers, which was very good. And knowledge sharing practices also changed. And finally, sustainability, in which close collaboration was done. Clear communication also was necessary for sustainability. And also the teachers and leadership thought that mutual benefits is completely necessary for the sustainability of the partnerships. And the numbers here are the number of the cases studied. The first two Myanmar cases, the Spanish case, and the Hungarian case. So just to finish, as always, more research has to be done. It was a pleasure to work with the whole team, Dilma, Kim, Judith, and hopefully it was a good experience for them as it was for me, and some literature. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Now we finished the presentation of the outcomes of the four pillars, and at this moment I would like to shift the role of moderator to Judith, who will moderate the question answer parts and the closing part.
So we have heard a lot of interesting presentations, which you can also read in the reports if you have the time and motivation. And now it's the time to ask questions or to share with us your dilemmas. Firstly, about the presentations. So you can also address questions to Helena's presentations, because she's in contact with Chila, so she can answer the questions. And so it will be like 15 minutes this part, and then Tibor, I will give the floor to Tibor, who will talk about the impacts and further sustainability of school university partnership. And during that part, we can also discuss more deeply into the school university partnership, the research itself, or its implications for the future as well. But now, if you
blended module, and then later I could see, and there's a gap between the theory and the practice, and we have to work something in the future. Maybe in Helena's presentation, she mentioned that in case of intensive MDR, the beauty contact, and the beauty contact for 40%. And I'm curious whether this group was in Budapest or was somewhere in Europe.
The same question is valid also for the literature review. So how much the development of universities by the partnership is covered by the literature? Another question related to the literature review is when we talk about research, or when the literature talks about research, how much traditional research is implemented? And research is not done by researchers, but by and then a question to Elena. So this part of the research was very particular because it was about it was focusing on the doctoral level. So my related question is how would how could we describe the most important difference between school-university partnership and business focusing on doctoral level, and when this is related with the, let's say, sub-doctoral level, the bachelor, master level. And a question to Daisy, which is related with the Hungarian case. So what do you think the general sector can learn from the VET sector as far as school-university partnerships are concerned? And a related other question, you did mention, I think, that the secondary school students were also involved. So my question is related with that. How do you think school students could be, should be involved in school-university partnership? And the last question, which is to all of you, I wonder whether you are familiar with the notion education innovation cluster. Education innovation cluster. So if you understand this, how do you think, what do you think that the similarity and the difference is between what we call education innovation cluster on the one hand and school university partnership on the other hand? How much these notions are overlapping?
One more question is about the teacher career development model, and in this the role of master and researcher teachers, and the question referred to how they can be involved in this school-university partnership triangle, knowledge triangle, which I mean like the school, the university, but also the state is involved. And further thing to but it's connected more to the next part of the event, so to divorce, how the school-university partnership can help to explore this knowledge of master teachers, researchers, teachers, and how they, it can be turned back into the innovation of education. So how this kind of thing, like school-university partnership, can help. And then I give the floor to the presenters who will answer. Yes. You can maybe you can sit there, yes, Daisy and Chiba, and you decide which order to answer.
Did you want to start because I'm still starting off with her name, so that she must try to answer.
I want to say that this empty seat is for Helena, who cannot be here, but is in heart and in stream with us. So the first question is about why should we compare and what is the common background? Yeah, we didn't compare. So what we did was extract the elements in the literature to make partnerships successful and analyze the case studies we had and see if each partnership had these elements and how these elements were expressed in the partnership. So that's why in the last table that you saw, there were like X depending if the element was present or was not present in the case studies. Because the contexts are completely different, even within Europe, from one school district to another, there can be major differences. So we didn't do a comparison. The second one was about the stakeholders, and the stakeholders that are mentioned more the most are leadership, university, teacher trainers, student teachers, and students. Yeah, it's true, but we also found in the literature, not in our case studies, many stakeholders. They are organizations. VET schools that are very integrated with the industrial sector for their students to do their practicum. Also in some instances, there is like government officials that are actually connected with these partnerships. So yes, these are kind of the five main stakeholders that are mentioned, but we have to keep our minds open, and there are cases, well, there are studies, and there are examples of many other stakeholders. The next question is about what do I think the general sector can learn from the BET sector from the point of view of school-university partnership? Well, first I'm going to go through the case study. I think we all can learn from what they are doing. I don't know actually if I should be answering this question or Judith should answer. Maybe both of us can do it. I think the obviously in the BET sector everything is hands-on, but I think we should and we could involve more our students with the real world. And I can say this because I had the opportunity to study in university in Norway, in which they have this approach. So it was not a full partnership, it was a full university. It was between a vocational education university and academic university, let's say. So, for example, when I had to do desk research, or anyone had to do desk research, they would actually push us to go to the real world. If you have to do this, then talk to this person. If you have to do that, try to do this with another person. So I think we can actually incorporate more hands-on experiences in our students. I don't know if Judith wants to say something?
I was also thinking about this question, and I was just, I would like to add that, so for example, this innovation, this special innovation in this special project of the Technical University, it is coming part from a disadvantage, from a disadvantage. So the content and the volume of vocational education content is quite insufficient. So there are not enough course books, there are not enough up-to-date materials in vocational education. So in a way, teachers are forced to innovate. This was one thing to mention. And the second one, which I noticed in this project, is that the teachers were very learner-centered. So they focused on the needs of the students, and they noticed that these students learn very differently than the students like 20 or 30 years ago. And because these pupils and students who learn at the vocational education sector, they are less motivated than students who learn in the general education sector. So the teachers need to put much more effort into keeping their attention or how to make them focus on the lessons. So they are much more forced to cater for the needs and for the interests of the students. So that's why these innovative tailor-made solutions could be formulated.
Could you connect this with student university partnerships?
It is connected because the Technical University is also a student teacher training place. So they have direct contact with teachers who are practitioners, but they are also their student teachers, because in vocational education they do the master degree after several years of practicing school. So in this way they actually learn from their students, because when they are teaching the subjects at the university level, their students know what they have to teach at secondary level, so there is an interaction between university teachers and secondary school teachers at the university level. Yeah.
So we should be innovating more. Mm-hmm. And how do you think this school students, students, because we have been students, should be involved in the school university partnership? Actually, in the cases we have, we unfortunately we didn't have involvement of students except for Judith's case. But I think that just one simple question could change upon our partnership or two. If we ask students, what do you want to learn and how do you want to learn, maybe we will come to answers, to interesting answers. I remember the first time I was asked this question, it was so rare for me that somebody will ask me, what do you want to learn and how, that I didn't have an answer, because we at least in some schools there is this archaic model, and we should probably go closer to a very big involvement of the students. Like, maybe they are young and they don't know all the nuances of research, of the pedagogical backgrounds or contexts, but they know how to make things interesting for them. How they learn and what they spend their time on. So I think just asking them questions, like taking successful cases into consideration, we can dramatically change. And maybe we will have students, actually students, not student teachers, as stakeholders in a close future. And it should be how, this is how it should be from my point of view, now that I have a closer look in the school university partnership. About the education innovation cluster and the school university partnership, I am not fully aware of the education innovation cluster, but what I can say is that the school university partnerships, like a big part of how they are perceived in the schools, is as a source of innovation. Like, there were not just by the leadership or the teachers or the teacher trainings, but they all expected to have some sort of innovation coming from the partnership, either new knowledge, new ways of working on a topic. And I think this is very, very valuable within this framework. But if you want to give me, Gabor, more nuanced definition of education innovation?
Not in this moment.
Not in this
we
moment.
We can talk about the question.
Yeah, and those were the questions, I think, if I left out one.
I think there was one more about why comparing the amount.
No, that
the
was
your
one.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Okay, first of all, I think that we don't have Helena with us. Mm-hmm. I sent her the questions, but there seems to be some problem with the connections. Anyway, in case she answers later, we will share the answers somehow. So I will try to keep an order of the questions as I receive them. So first, I mentioned as about the reciprocity of the benefits, and I think that this reciprocity resonates with a lot of results that we had and even some questions that Gabor posted. So it's the first thing that occurred to me when I heard your question was the thing that, unfortunately, most of the times the school university partnerships are dominated by a lot of partners, and that is mostly the university. Mm-hmm. And if you remember the last slide of Helena's presentations, she was quoting, and she was the snobism in academia. So I think that all these things, like, you know, end up and this is a big issue that we need to tackle. So I think that this reciprocity is what we should aim. Because, we can, you know, call each other snobs or whatever, that won't solve the problem, but to try to find a balance in the workload, in responsibilities, shared leadership. I mean, there are many, many different ways on how to tackle this issue. And I also remembered one of the post-it notes that we put up somewhere, I don't know where, we came up with the idea within our team discussions that these partnerships might need a facilitator. Because these are two words, we can agree that these are two words. Sometimes we find ways to each other, but most of the times we speak different languages, we have different motivations, intentions, aims, etc., etc. And actually, to facilitate this collaboration, why don't we involve people who know how to facilitate? In the previous event that we had, Tibor took this responsibility, and I think that it was a wonderful example of how a partnership, even if it was only for one day, but how one activity, when it is facilitated by a professional, would flourish and result in creating valuable and practical ideas. So yeah, for with reciprocity, I would go for balance in workload, in responsibility, in leadership, in aims. Have I answered your question?
Yes.
Then with the blended model, I just looked up. It was in the content calendar, so the respondents got to choose from the three EDITE models that were defined in the guidelines. But one participant said that he or she used the blended model, namely she or he had the mixture of the simple and the structured model, but still not the intensive. So this person, you know, visited the partner organizations, saw what was happening there, used the partner organizations as a field for his or her research, but never really gave back anything.
So he or she was a silent partner.
Yes, and this was the most common in the context. That he used the partner organizations for the research. Then or she had a question about the participants because they might seem a bit homogeneous, and yes, it is like that. We extracted the participants of the research that each of the studies focused in the system or in the literature review, because it's not a systematic. So we have a list, and the list is, you know, when we look at it, it's quite diverse because there are like more than 100. Participants, but under different names, and actually when we look deeply, they are, you know, teacher educators and their synonyms, in-service teachers and their synonyms, and we label them, so we have university-based teacher educators, school-based teacher educators, teachers, so practitioners, student teachers, management, leadership, so this is all, and we have one category labeled as other, and in that category we have a mention, like we have two interesting things. One article mentions practicing scientists. So what they did is that in their school-university partnership, they involved practicing scientists, but not from the university, so let's say from the industry. Yeah. And that brought like a new dimension into it. And there is one mention of involving key participants from municipality. Okay. But usually we stay in the close circle of ours.
Okay.
Okay. And then Gabor asked about if we have any information on practitioner research being done. This is for the systematic literature review part, and unfortunately we didn't code this. So this is something that next time when we do it we will code it, but since I was the coordinator of this pillar, I coded a lot of articles and I went through most of the articles that was coded by the other participants, the other researchers, and practitioner research is not a big thing. It appeared in a few studies, but those were most like, I wouldn't even call them case studies, just like case illustrations. So when there was a partnership that was really flourishing and mutually valuable for both of the partners, then they might involve the practitioners, the teachers, someone from the school to describe it, to give their point of view, but it's not a typical thing that would come from the practitioner research. Yes, and now I will change the order a this resonates with Ida's question related to the career model and the teachers, or researchers, teachers, and master teachers, because that's where we talk about practitioner research. And if we, I know in Hungary, if someone hears the career model, there are many different reactions, sometimes positive, sometimes negative, but it is what it is, we have it, so we have to deal with it. But I do think that the career model has some aspects that force or motivates the teachers. It's up to us how we interpret it to go beyond the school. Not only to consume the research, the knowledge, but to be the producer of the knowledge. And this is actually the terms towards practitioner research. And this is a topic from my heart because I was dealing with this in my PhD studies. I was looking how research or inquiry appears in initial teacher education, because I think that initial teacher education has an important role in changing the direction, because if it is grounded, if student teachers get an introduction, if they get sensitized towards practitioner research, then later on in their career they might tackle this issue. They might be more open to cooperations, to practitioner research, to collaborative research. We haven't really mentioned collaborative research. Because I think that after practitioner research, that is even more valuable form of research. Versus the school-university partnerships. I do think, also I am not very familiar with this. I have just reading readings on the topic, but I do think that education innovation cluster is something much broader in the sense of the participants, in the sense of the aims, in the sense of their goals, means. Since it's a cluster, I do believe that it involves, how shall I put it, maybe bigger or better conditions of funding, finances. So maybe it's easier to maintain such clusters. But this is just my very naive opinion about it. Yes, I forgot to mention this because we don't try. This is something that we didn't really code, but when I heard your question, but again, this is my kind of opinion. I'm not sure that we could have found a lot of things, because if you think back the results of the quantitative pillar, there was one statement which was very highly agreed by most of the participants that universities influence schools and not the other way around. So this would be an interesting thing to look at, how schools could influence universities, but I'm not sure that we could actually get anything out of this questionnaire related to this.
Not now,
not at this, yes.
Maybe the respondents were related to schools and yes, respondents on the
I meant that the answers that we got now, but this would be the aim. Would be the aim. When they don't talk about these things as in theory, because I'm sure that if we would ask people, they would have a lot of ideas how it could be done, but in the real life, more was than everyday practice. At least in the EDITE context, it wasn't extractable from our
answer. Thank you very much for your answers and your contribution. Is there any questions left? Anyone for the time being? If not, then I would like to give the floor to people who will talk about the impact implications of this research and the.
People in
and that or I'm sure and like the further sustainability.
So, when I was thinking about the impact benefits and the future plans, I thought maybe I would share with you more my impressions, which is of course based on facts and events. And not making, let's say, a rigorous analysis of the whole process and referring on different content, issues, events, numbers, and so on. But I hope what I can say, it will inspire your thinking. So, firstly, about the impact and the impacts and benefits. Maybe one of the most important impact is that we could recognize the importance of this field. When we did the workshop at the beginning of June, one group defined that however, the school university partnership research is an existing field, but that aspect we had in the EDITE program, especially the cooperation initiated by the doctoral school with partner organization focusing really on schools, it is quite new thing, which as Jonas and Michelle, it has some kind of reciprocal effect. So it is not only the university can influence the school and the school life, but if the university open enough, saying frankly, then it can come back and the school can influence also the university. I will give some example on that, how it is possible. The second what I can mention is that the traditional wall between the academic sphere and the practice sphere, so the university and the schools or the academics and the practicing teachers, maybe disappeared or at least became thinner. So you also had some reflection regarding that the school and the university means different words, following different values, sometimes use different languages. I think one of the impact or at the same time benefit that we have more common languages, language than we had earlier. The case study, Daisy mentioned in one point that how much important the joint work among the stakeholders from the beginning during the whole process. So it is not the case that let's ask the schools what they think about the educational doctoral program, they give some answer and we do something. Neither the other way, that we give some messages to the doctoral school that you should research this area or that field, and that's all. But it is a common verb from the beginning to the end, which is repeated and repeated. I think this way of thinking, again, a kind of benefit. Of course, we can recognize the bottlenecks and the problems, also a kind of learning results, the lack of sources for especially regard the time. However, I have to mention that the time is the most democratic thing in our life, because everyone has 86,400 seconds a day, and you can decide how you use it, and it is valid for the teacher and the classroom, the school leaders, when the school leader decide whether or not join to such kind of program or not. The doctoral schools, which define the topics, the field for research, and so on and so on. So, the next, it also appeared among the reflection, I think that was one of the results of the pillar two, that we do not have a clear enough concept for the cooperation. However, we have a written concept on that. And I think that is quite clear that, okay, we have a concept, but the question is not only the concept itself, but how we can make it real. What kind of procedures we need on both sides, on behalf of the partner organizations, on behalf of the doctoral schools, and also personal level, to make it real, the concept. And if you want to continue this program, I think we should answer such a question. Anyway, of course, what we experienced, it is a normal life of the innovation. And as I mentioned, the EU doctoral school cooperation can recognize really as a kind of innovation. And something about the future. I think we need a clear a balance between the creativity and engineering regarding the planning. So it means that we need attractive goals and ideas. And behind that, we need a clear plan how we can realize it. So keep your head above the clouds, but stay on the earth 2 feet. The second is, also regarding the future, some example, maybe some challenging question. Do you imagine the doctoral schools as service provider for schools, where the doctoral students act as consultant? So it is a question regarding the role of the doctoral school itself, as I mentioned at the beginning. And if your answer is yes, then we should find the way how it can work in the reality. Of course, it has another question, because the coin has another side. Do you imagine the partner organizations can have even more role, bigger role in contributing to enhance researchers' competencies of the doctoral students? And if the answer is again yes, then the question is what activities we need to enhance the doctoral school's competencies at the partner organization when they are there? And as it came again on the table, how we can inspire the actors to move from the simple role towards the intensive role during this process. Yes, I mentioned the activities. So maybe these two questions also refer on the reciprocity of the process. How the doctoral school can support schools and other organizations, also teacher training organizations, in doing better job than they have done until now. And also, how the partner organizations can support the doctoral schools to modify the content of the program, find the best topics which is really important, both academic point of view and the practitioner point of view. So maybe it needs some creative workshops, defining a medium term plan for 3-5 years. But behind that, it is absolutely necessary to have a clear action plan, at least one year. So in this case, I can suggest make clear what we can and want to do under what conditions. So do it and make it real. It needs activities and cooperation, personal, organizational level, and need a strong leadership. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Stuart. That was a wonderful summary. To add a few things. First, that I think that we can state that this research has been a good investment. So I think that the idea came from you to start it. I had to take the responsibility to decide on the group, and I think that that was a good decision. It has produced valuable knowledge for both the editor community, the international one, and also for people, institutions here within the country. But the second is that I think that this research confirmed that the school-university partnership is a strategic issue. I remember when 15, 20 years ago, a decision was taken in the Center for Education Research and Innovation of OECD to launch activities on knowledge management in education. Knowledge management that is producing knowledge, sharing knowledge, and using knowledge. And I think that what we were doing here, that was to look at knowledge management in a specific institutional framework. And this just confirmed what the OECD recognized 15, 20 years ago. So this is a really an important strategic issue from an education policy point of view. And the third is that I think that it confirmed that it is a promising research area, also from the perspective of opening windows to other areas. So this topic is a kind of catalyzing topic. Doing research in this area can help us to understand things also in other areas. So I would definitely recommend to those who are coming to me, in what area should I do research? Do research in school university partnership, because that will open a door for you to enter many, 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 many different areas. We knew, and that was confirmed by this research, that this school-university partnership is a difficult, challenging area, but I think that thanks to the knowledge accumulated and which was synthesized here, we also have the knowledge about those conditions which can make this difficult area work. And one of these things is, as you also underline, conceptual understanding. But the next thing is that I think that the research confirmed that this is a multifunctional area. The school university partnerships have very different functions. Beyond what is classically seen as the most important function, developing the skills of teachers and research, school development is important. But here I would like to react to what you, your question you addressed to doctoral schools about whether doctoral students could be work as consultants. Well, this is something which we have already been doing here in our doctoral school. Our doctoral students, they were doing consultancy work of school development or school evaluation, and I could see what a wonderful impact that had on their own academic learning. By the way, our best doctoral students were doing this, this work. And I know that also the National Association of Doctoral Students, is proposing this. They recognized that the pool of doctoral students in the whole country, this is a huge amount of knowledge that logically should be used by institutions. And that's not for education, it's for including every sector. I think that the research also confirmed that this is a very complex area, but this complexity also means that many, many opportunities can be opened by creating and sustaining school leadership, but we need the knowledge, and I think that there are very, very interesting small knowledge elements that came out from this research. For instance, what Lisa mentioned, the one tier and two tier partnerships, those who include, for example, school network components, and those who do not. So we could create a kind of typology that could help us to understand. But as for the follow-up, I think that those who are interested in modernizing teacher education, including induction in continuous professional development, they are certainly interested in using the results. We can use that and we can provide some follow-up in two research projects we are running now. One is on the continuous professional development of teachers. So I'm trying to use this as an input for this program. And also, of course, in the research we are doing on innovation, education innovation. Fortunately, we have doctoral students who are interested in the topic. One of them is Kim Kim, who is still perhaps following us, but it's very late in Myanmar now. I mentioned just one very personal thing. With one of my colleagues, we have just finished the manuscript of a strange book, which is a mixture of fiction and academic writing. And school-university partnership is a key component. You will see when it will be published. So we, and again, let me thank you for this wonderful contribution you brought in. I hope that many elements of that will appear in your introductory concluding chapters, including the knowledge which is there on the board. Most of it was generated with your help. So this is my conclusion.
Thank you
very
much. And
I
would like to send all our partner organizations that they contributed in this three-year of venture in this project, and I will give it to Catherine Tudor to hand over it in an alphabetical order. So the first one is Deb.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you for everything we learn from you and each other.
Thank you so much.
Sorry of saying this just two sentences in Hungarian. Félig tudományos munkában van egy egész fejezet. A iskoláitól vágjunk, hogy megkereste a magukat. Hát kell egy hozzájárulás, hogy ott nem is. Research project. A special thanks also for the other participating researchers, the doctoral students, international and national doctoral students, and to the partner organizations. We really would like to find some way to keep this partnership alive. Great thanks to Tibor, who had a key role in the whole process, not only in the research, but also in the whole partnership building process from the very beginning of the program, bringing in great ideas. Let me just mention just one, the three types of partnership. That's an idea that came from your brain. And a special thanks to EDITE, who was not just managing the whole project, this research project, but also contributing substantially to it with ideas, with insights. So thank you for this, EDITE, and as I mentioned, if I remember well, the whole idea came from you to launch this research project. So thank you very much for all of you. And this is the end of our
Thank you. Thank you.